If you hear, grab yourself a Bible. Deacon Hunt, turn it on for you. If you need a Bible, raise your hand. Amen. Not going to keep you long. It's Halloween, all right? Thank God for that. That's it. Turn me to the book of Psalm 75. The book of Psalm 75. The book of Psalm 75. Sorry about the sound. We're going to get this fixed. The book of Psalm 75. Will you guys say amen? The book of Psalms 75. The book of Psalm 75. Before we get started, let's give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. All right, come on. We can do better than that. Give God a hand clap. You made it to see October 31st, 2023. Psalm 75. Go down to verse 6. Psalm 75. Go down to verse 6. We're going to get these mics situated. If I got to do it myself. Psalm 75. Go down to verse 6. It says, for promotion cometh neither from the east nor the west, nor from the north or the south. But then it says, but God is the judge. For he putteth down one, and he setteth up another. It says, for promotion come from the east nor the west, nor from the north nor the south. But it says, God is the judge, for he putteth down one, and he setteth up another. God is the one who determines who shall be successful. It is God who determines whether we wake up or whether we rest for eternity. It is God who determines how the light changes yellow, green, or red. It is God who determines who gets cancer and who gets saved. It's God who determines who gets a heart transplant and who gets well. It's God who determines everything. It says, for promotion comes neither from the south, nor from the north, nor the west, but it all comes from God. How does God determine whom he will bless? How does God determine who will live and who will die? How will God determine who will be rich and who will be poor? What is it that God used to determine the things that will happen in our life? Next, turn me to Psalms 44 and 3. Thank you, Jesus. Psalms 44 and 3. Psalms 44 and 3. So we see that life is not happenstance. Psalms 44 and 3. It says, and they got not the land in possession by their own sword, neither did they their own arm save them. But thy right hand and thine arm and the light of thy countenance, because thou hast favor unto them. God says you didn't get it off the muscle. God says you didn't earn anything. In fact, the very things that you have are a gift from God. In fact, God says, I'm the one who determined what you will get in your life. God says, I'm the one who gave you favor. And here's the thing about favor. God's favor is not fair. So how is it that God determines whom he will bless and who will be cursed? How is it that God determines who will be rich and who will be poor? Let's see. Next, turn me to Genesis 25 and 21. Genesis, the book of Genesis. 25 and 21. The book of Genesis. 25. And 21. The book of Genesis. 25 and 21. Genesis 25 and 21 says this. And Isaac entreated the Lord for his wife, because she was barren. And the Lord was entreated of him. And Rebekah, his wife, conceived. And the children struggled together within her. And she says, if it be so, why am I thus? And she went, and she inquired of the Lord. And the Lord said to her, there are two nations in thy womb, and two manner of people, and they shall be separated from thy bowels, and the one people shall be stronger than the other people, and the elder shall serve the younger. What does it mean for you and I? There was a woman named Rebekah. She was the wife of a man named Isaac. And the thing about Rebekah was, she couldn't have children. She had lived almost her entire life, and she couldn't get pregnant. Short story, her husband went to God and said, God, I want some children. And they prayed. And God finally got her pregnant. Now, when she got pregnant, she was pregnant with twins. One named Jacob and another named Esau. And the thing about these twins, they struggled from the day that they were conceived. They struggled from birth. They would fight each other. Even in the mother's womb, they would fight each other. They would fight to see who would be the one who will receive the blessing of the Lord. What does that mean for you and I? One thing about blessing is this. In order for you to have blessing, you have to be a fighter. In order for you to be blessed, you have to learn how to overcome. In order for you to be blessed, you can't give up when the tough get going. In order for you to be blessed, you have to persevere and endure to the end. It said that these twins were even fighting in the womb. They were struggling with each other to see who would become the one that would have success. Next, go to Genesis 27. In Genesis 27. If you read Genesis 27, I'm not going to read it because it's quite long. It says that Esau was strong, but Jacob was smart. Esau was the stronger of the two brothers. In fact, he was a hunter. He would go out to the field and he would hunt. But Jacob stayed at home and studied his lesson. What does that mean for you and I? You're never more like God than when you acquire knowledge. It's not your strength that's going to determine your prosperity. It's what you know that will determine how far you go. The thing about us is we don't like to study. We don't want to read. We don't want to do all these things. In fact, they got this thing called AI. Bishop was talking about the other night. He said, ooh, AI helped me to write my paper. The thing is, we want to do everything artificially. We want to do everything and make everything easier to do. And God says, you still have to know something. Because God is not going to bless you with something if you don't know nothing. God says you have to learn how to study. So Jacob was one that studied. Now, the interesting thing about Jacob ended up stealing his brother's blessings. Let me tell you a story. The older child was supposed to inherit the blessings from the father. But Jacob saw that his brother wasn't very smart. In fact, his brother was so not smart that he sold his birthright to his brother. So since Jacob stole the birthright, he saw that his brother Esau would sell his own blessings if he got in trouble. What does that mean for you and I? Don't you ever sell your soul to get something that you think you need. Don't you ever sell your soul to compromise your values. Don't you ever compromise your values to get where you think you need to be. Because if you will sell your soul, God is not going to bless you because he knows that whenever you get in trouble, you won't be loyal to him. God says, I want to bless those who will bless me in regards to what I'm going through. The other night, I was watching a movie about Dr. King. And the interesting thing about Dr. King, we all know the story. You all seen the speeches. You all know the thing. But his wife never left his side. Dr. King's wife never left his side. The interesting thing about Dr. King's wife was the FBI would send her pictures of Dr. King with other women. She never walked away from Dr. King. They would send her pictures of him doing things and sending love letters to other women, but she never walked away from Dr. King. Why did Coretta Scott stay with a man who had cheated on her? Why did Coretta Scott not walk away from this man? Because she said, I know it's greater than me. She said, I know this thing is about freeing kids that I've never met before. She knows that they would have an opportunity to do things that we never could do before. So she says, I'll take the sacrifice. God says, I bless those who are willing to sacrifice and who will be committed to what I called them to do. The problem with this generation, the only person you committed to is to yourself. You ain't committed to nothing. You won't stand for nothing. You won't do nothing. And because you won't do nothing, God says, the blessing shall be removed from you. God says, I bless those who will be a blessing unto me, who will be committed unto me. God says, the commitment is what God wants from you. God wants people who will stand for him. regardless of whether COVID is going on, regardless of what is going on. God says, stand for me and live. Stand for me. Sometimes you might die, but if you stand for Christ, you will live through an eternity. God says, stand for me. Next, go to Genesis 28 and 20. Genesis 28 and 20. Genesis 28 and 20. Genesis 28 and 20. It's all going to make sense in a minute. Genesis 28 and 20. And then it says, and Jacob vowed a vow, saying, if God will be with me, and if he will keep me in this way that I go, and if he will give me bread to eat, and if he will give me clothes to put on, so that I can come again to my father's house in peace, then shall the Lord be my God. And this stone, which I have set for a pillar, shall be God's house. And all that I have, I shall give, and I surely will give a tenth unto thee. Jacob, after he got the blessings of God, he committed his life to serve God. And in serving God, he knew that God would guarantee him peace. Some of you need to know that all the money in the world won't give you peace. There's so many people right now who have wealth, but no peace. There's so many people right now who have fame, but no peace. Because peace is a gift that comes from God. And the thing with Jacob, when he took this vow, he says, I see that all that God has done for me. And I thank you, Lord, for all that you've done for me. And God, I'm going to serve you. I'm going to serve you and not serve myself. When you want the blessings of God, you have to know that you have to be loyal to God. You have to be faithful to God. Jacob said, God, I'm going to serve you. It's not about me. When you really get real with God, you find out it's not about me. You know where I'd rather be right now? On a beach in Jamaica. You know where I'd rather be right now? In West Hollywood, walking up and down, drinking a Coca-Cola. But the thing is, God says, it's Tuesday night. It's Bible study. Be faithful unto me. You got to learn how to put God first and not put you first. And you have to learn how to ignore the devil. Because the devil wants to put you first. Because the devil knows if you first, then you will be last. But if you put God first, he'll make you first. And he'll bless you in spite of you. He'll prosper you in spite of you. He'll give you success. He'll give you everything that you ask for if you learn how to put him first. Next, turn me to the book of Esther. The book of Esther. Go to Psalms, make a left. The book of Esther. We're going to go to Esther 1 and 10. The book of Esther. Chapter 1, go down to verse 10. The book of Esther. Go down to chapter 1, go down to verse 10. It says, on the seventh day, when the heart of the king was merry with wine, he commanded Mephman, Bizda, Harbana, Bigda, and Abagatha, Zathar, and Carcass, the sever of his chamberlains, that served in the presence of the king of Ahasuerus, the king. Verse 11. And he told them to bring Vashti, the queen, before the king and the crown royal, to show the people and the princess her beauty, for she was very beautiful to look upon. But the queen Vashti refused to come at the king's commandment by his chamberlains. Therefore the king was very angry, and the anger burned in him. Let's look at this. There was a lady named Queen Vashti. She was the queen of everything that we know as Ethiopia. Ethiopia at that time was half of Africa. She was the queen from India all the way to Africa. She had a husband named King Ahasuerus. They were having a party. And at the party, the husband was drinking and he got kind of faded. He said, man, go get my baby, man. He told his boys, hey, go get my baby. And his boys like, all right, let's go get the queen. But when they went to the queen's chambers, they went to go get her. She says, I ain't going. Now, when she said, I ain't going, she embarrassed the king. Because he's the king of all of India. He's the king of all of North Africa. He's the king as far as Egypt, all the way down to Ethiopia. He had a vast kingdom. How is it that the queen wouldn't heed the words of the king? So the king was very angry. Put a pin in that. Next, turn with me to Isaiah 20 and 2. Isaiah 20 and 2. Isaiah 20 and 2. I want you to show what it looks like when you have to follow God. Isaiah 20 and 2. This is going to sound crazy to you. Isaiah 20 and 2. And it says, at the same time spake the Lord by Isaiah the son of Amoz, saying, go and loose thy sackcloth from thy loins, and put off thy shoes off thy feet. And Isaiah did so, walking around naked and barefoot. And the Lord said, like as my servant Isaiah hath walked around naked and barefoot for 3 years, for this is a sign and a wonder for all those from Egypt and upon Ethiopia. So shall the king of Assyria lead away the captive Egyptians prisoners, and the Ethiopian captives, the young and the old, naked and barefoot, even with their buttocks uncovered, to the shame of Egypt. Let me translate that. God had a disciple named Isaiah. God had a disciple named Isaiah. And God called Isaiah, and he spoke to him. And he said, Isaiah, I want you to do something really crazy, man. And Isaiah was like, what you talking about, God? And he says, tomorrow morning, I want you to get up, take off all your clothes, take off your shoes, and I want you to go walking. Isaiah must have said, God, you tripping. But God says, Isaiah, I'm charging you to do this thing for me. He said, because by you doing this thing for me, you're not only going to do this thing for me, you're going to save the lives of billions. Now, Isaiah had a choice. He could have said, that wasn't God speaking to me. He could have said, ain't no way in the world I'm walking out this house butt naked. God, you tripping. But Isaiah said, God, if you telling me to take my clothes off and walk butt naked, I'm going to walk butt naked for 3 years. And Isaiah took off his clothes and he went to the supermarket naked. He went to the grocery store naked. He went to the club naked. He went to the church naked. He went everywhere naked because he was following the will of God. Here's the thing. Why would Isaiah do such a thing? Because Isaiah didn't have pride. He trusted God more than he worried about what people thought about him. One of the biggest things that will hold you back in life is when you try to figure and make other people's opinion matter what happens to you. If you want to be successful, you can't worry about what people think about you. Here's one of the powerful things. Donald Trump is not very popular with a lot of folks. But Donald Trump is so caught up in his own mind, he don't care what you think about him. Because he said, I got $2 billion. I don't care what your little broke janitor butt thing. I got $2 billion. He's so caught up in who he is. And sometimes you have to know who you are in Christ Jesus. Isaiah trusted God more than he worried about what man said. Tonight, before I got up here to stand up and look like a fool, don't you think I want to walk around here in a dress and walk around with a fake thing on? But God said, I want you to dress up to show the people what it looks like when you follow God. Sometimes you will look foolish following God, but you look foolish to man, but to God be the glory. For I'd rather be approved by God than be approved by man. See, the thing is, men gonna always talk about you. I don't care whether you was perfect or whether you was all the way wrong. Your best friend, as soon as you leave the room, she calls somebody else, she's talking about you. The thing is, we have to understand you can never appease man. So always live to satisfy God. There was another man, his name was Hosea. And in the book of Hosea 1 and 2, God told Hosea to marry a girl who was a prostitute. I want you to think about that. Hosea 1 and 2. God said, Hosea, you my man, right? Yeah, God. You run my churches. Yeah, God, got you, God, got you. He said, man, it's time for you to get married. Hosea was excited. It's time for me to get married, God? Yeah, man. But he says, those nice girls, I don't want you to marry them. I said, what you talking about, God? He said, I want you to go down to Figueroa. I want you to drive down the street. I want you to find the one with the biggest booty and the nicest thong on. And he says, that's the one I want you to marry. Hosea looked at, was thinking, God. And if you read Hosea, it talks about, are you sure about this, God? And he said, I want you to marry a woman that's going to cheat on you. In fact, she's going to cheat on you so much, you're going to have to go pick her up from other men's houses. Now, what do you think about this? Hosea was a big-time pastor where he was. He was had a big old church. He was prosperous. He was doing well. God told the man who was high to go marry a woman that was low. But Hosea trusted God more than he cared about what men thought about him. And he married the girl who cheated on him. He married the girl that embarrassed him with his friends. But in doing so, he received the blessings of the Lord. What does that mean for you and I? You have to understand that it's not about appeasing self. It's all about what God wants you to do. Because the thing is, before the beginning began to begin, God already knew the life that you would have. He already made a way for you to escape the things that the enemy had meant to start to destroy you. Some things that you choosing, God ain't in it. And it looks right to you. And you choosing this thing, not realizing that the devil's on the other side of that thing. And if you follow that pathway, you will lead to a path that leads to death. God says, choose the path that leads to life. He says, narrow is the path that leads to life. Wide is the road that leads to destruction. Next, turn back to Esther 2 and 17. Thank you, Jesus. We're almost done. Esther 2 and 17. Thank you, Jesus. Esther, thank you, Jesus. 2 and 17. Esther 2 and 17. Esther 2 and 17 says this. And the king loved Esther above all other women. And then it says, and she obtained grace and favor in his sight more than all the other virgins, so that he set up a royal crown upon her head, sort of like what I'm wearing tonight. And he made her queen instead of Vashti. There's a woman named Esther. Y'all don't know much about Esther, but let me tell you a story about Esther. Esther lived in a foster home. Her mother and her father had died. She had no family. She had no sibling. She had nobody. She lived in a foster home. And see, but the thing about Esther was, God gave her a gift. It was her beauty. And although she was in her foster home, her uncle Mordecai went and got her off the foster home. And he said, Esther, I know your parents did, but I'm going to raise you. Esther was humble because she came from nothing. Esther was humble because she appreciated everything that somebody gave to her. What does that mean for you and I? If you want to be successful, you have to take advantage of every opportunity. If you want to be successful, you have to take advantage of every opportunity. Esther didn't have pride like many of us have. Esther wasn't a proud person because if she looked at her life, she had nothing to be proud of. Both her parents died. She lived in a foster home. She had nothing. So everything that somebody gave to her, she appreciated. But the thing was, God gave her a gift. It was her beauty. And it was that beauty that allowed her to become the queen. When the queen told the king, we started off, when the queen told the king that I'm not coming to see you, she stood in pride. But she didn't realize that the Bible says pride always comes before destruction. And pride will bring you down. And that pride took her down. And God took up a girl who was a foster child. He took up a girl who had nothing. He took up a girl who had low self-esteem. He picked up a girl and he says, you will be queen because you will submit and humble unto me. What does that mean for you and I? Never take folks for granted. Never take your opportunities for granted. When you get an opportunity, do the best you can. Never take every day for granted. Every day that you live is an opportunity to do something different. Because you don't know when God's going to call you home. And he's going to charge you with the time that you have. What are you doing with the opportunities that God has given to you? Tomorrow is a new day. What will you do different tomorrow than you did today? God says, use the time. He says, redeem the time, for the days are evil. Use the time that he's given you. Use the opportunity that he's given you. Use the connections that he's given you. Because God is watching you. and he's going to bless you according to how you use your blessings. See, the thing about a lot of us, we waste so many blessings. We waste opportunities. I'm at the head of that line. I had an opportunity to do different things. But every time you miss it, God just lowers you down a little bit. And he keeps dropping you until you learn your lesson. Until you learn that I got to trust you, God. I got to follow you, God. I got to make this thing happen. And here's the very last thing. Turn to Galatians 6 and 9. We done after this. Galatians 6 and 9. Thank you, Jesus. Galatians 6 and 9. And let us not be weary in well-doing. For in due season, we shall reap if we faint not. What does that mean? God says this. You've been working a long time. You've been struggling a long time. You've been going through this thing for a long time. And some of you have already given up on the dreams that you had. But God says, don't you give up. He says, you will prosper if you faint not. That means you can't give up on what God has shown you. It's so sad. I work at a middle school. Now look into the eyes of 11 and 12-year-old girls who've already given up on their dreams. They've already given up. And they haven't even reached 18 yet. Do not let the devil trick you with the things that you see. Because the thing is, God says, eyes have not seen, nor ears heard, the things which I have for you. Nobody knows what God has for you except God. So you have to keep doing your best with what you got. You have to make it work. You can't let the devil trick you because you poor. And I'm going to end this story with this. I met an African guy. I think I told you this. He grew up in a town where they had no lights, no electricity, no running water. In fact, he didn't say he got his first pair of shoes until he was 18 years old. He didn't get his first pair of shoes until he was 18 years old. He lived in a town where the teacher only came once a month. But those children from that town became doctors, lawyers, and attorneys. They became businessmen because they understood, I don't have nothing. So I have to envision something. And they dreamed of things that they ain't never seen before. And today, there's some of the most well-to-do people that I know because they never gave up because they had nothing. Because they say, I'm trusting God. I can't touch him. But faith is the substance and the evidence of things unseen. It's your faith that will take you up and raise you up. It's your faith that will change the negative circumstances into positivity. You have to learn how to trust in a God that you've never seen to get to a place that you've never been to before. If you can trust God with what you don't have, he can get you to a place where you will have everything that you need. So the lesson for you tonight on Halloween 2023, trust God. Make the best of every opportunity. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Everybody stand. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Come on, we do better than that. Give God a hand clap. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. For some of you, it's like, well, this didn't hit me tonight. Opportunity. Opportunity don't come always. See, the thing is, once you miss an opportunity, it might be another day, another year, or another decade before you get that opportunity again. So what God wants you to know is, make the best of your opportunities. Because you don't want to be waiting around for the next bus to come. I remember back in the day, I used to take the RTD, y'all call it the Metro now. And the thing was, I would run to the bus stop, but if you miss that bus, one could come in another 20 minutes, or one could come in another 2 hours. So don't miss the opportunity, because every time you miss an opportunity, you miss the opportunity to be blessed. And God says, I have to put you down lower and lower. I remember this, one of my favorite pastors preached this message. He said, there's a man that died and he went to heaven, And when he got to heaven, he was walking with the angels. And as he was walking, he saw a door with all his names on it. This was a dream that one of these pastors had. He says, yeah, he saw a door and had all his names on it. And as he was walking, he kept seeing his name on all these doors. And then he stopped and said, hey, Gabriel, what these doors mean? He said, man, you don't want to look in there. He said, man, why my name on all these doors? He said, just keep walking with me. We almost in heaven. We almost there. So he stopped and he opened the door and he saw dreams. He stopped and opened another door and he saw more dreams. And he said, why didn't I get these things? And he said, because you missed the opportunity. Don't be like most of us and miss the opportunities that God has for you. Be like Esther, who was a lady who came from foster care, who had nobody, who had nothing. She didn't even have a dream, but she was humble. And when God gave her the opportunity, she did what God called her to do. Don't stand in pride. What's one of the things? See, pride is what took Satan down. That's why Satan had to go to hell, because he was proud. Ain't no man gonna tell me this. My woman, whatever it is, don't ever stand in pride. Always stand in humility. Because if you're humble, God can bless you. Amen. Anybody have any words? We wrap this up. All right, everybody grab a hand. Everybody turn around, please. Bow your hands. Dear Heavenly Father, we stand here at the altar tonight to learn a lesson from Queen Vashti and from Queen Esther. Father, humble our spirits. Father, I rebuke the enemy of pride. I rebuke that spirit that says I'm better than. And I ask you, Father, that you replace it with humility, that you replace it with humbleness, Father. But Father, help us to become more humble. Help us to seek you. Help us to be more obedient, to follow the will and the way that you said, Father. I rebuke the enemy over anything that he put in the pathway of these young people. And tonight, for 2023 Halloween, Father, we ask that you change the course of our path if we're walking down the wrong street, Father. Help us to seek the way that you have for us, Father. Even if we have to be embarrassed by man, I'd rather be embarrassed for you, Father, to stand on your word. Squeeze the hand next to you. I squeeze life into that hand. I squeeze prosperity into that hand. I squeeze vision and purpose into that hand. So these young people become the head and not the tail. So they become victorious and never defeated. So that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. We ask all that in Jesus' name. Amen. You got a hand clap. How did you?